Hello and welcome to the Rhythm Factory. I'm Eddie C, and together with my co-host Peter D, we're going to bring you in touch with people in and around the music business. This is the podcast that takes you up close and personal.
And Happy New Year to everybody. Our first podcast for 2015. My name is Eddie C, and to my far right is my colleague, Mr. Peter D. We have a very special guest for the beginning of the year, Mr. Arnold van Nieuwenhuizen. And Arnold and I, we go way back.
Back to the early 70s, 76, 77.
We were actually practically neighbors.
Very long time ago, yeah.
In a little town called Vlaardingen, where back in my student days, he was actually one of the first musicians I met when I came to Holland as a student. And we've been good friends and great colleagues ever since. Arnold, why don't you tell a little bit about yourself before we get into the questions?
What shall I tell?
Well, start from the beginning, my friend.
Well, musician, playing the drums all my life, I think, yeah, almost all my life. Still, I hope I have a lot of time to go to play the drums. Yeah, did a lot of things in music world. I presume you want to hear about music.
Yeah, well, as well, but we're gonna ask you. You know, this is the podcast that takes you up close and personal. Let's say sorry to interject. I know that you started at the age of 14. You know, playing in local bands, and at one point, you know, what was your main influence that started your whole career and you know, made you the drummer that you are today?
That was funny. Oh, funny, because in the 60s, I had an older brother. And in the 60s, it looked like, but it was almost like that, that every part of Vlaardingen or Rotterdam or whatever had groups. There were a lot of pop groups. Everybody was thinking that he can sing or play or whatever. And my brother, my older brother, he, I think he thought he was a good singer. He wasn't, but but he was practicing for the mirror, and he had a band, and I was like, little kid when I was, I think, around 10 or 12, and I was always like, wow, you know, band, and I always watched him and followed him, and then at that time, because also he brought in all the popular music.
Right.
So he came with bands like The Who, like Jimi Hendrix, like for me it was totally new and very exciting.
Yeah.
And I always built my own drum set in the bedroom.
Okay.
Old washing boxes.
Okay. Yeah. Right.
And then
my
brother invited me. He said, you can join us with the rehearsal with the band." I said, "Okay." And then they make fun about me, like, you play with us. And then I played, and I played even better than their drummer. And I always had the problem that I couldn't convince my parents that I really want to become a drummer. They always said, "No, you better can start with guitar or do something like that, not a drum kit." But then it was, clear. And also the drummer, he gave me my first snare drum.
Right.
So then I told him, yes, now I have to go on to the music school. Because now I have an instrument. So
then turning back.
So that's how it started.
Okay, fantastic.
Yeah. And also there's one, also when I heard, that was, I think I was 14 or 15, I think, then for the first time I heard my Vishnu Orchestra with Billy Cobham. My whole thing opened, like, wow, that is what I want
to do. Yeah. You know,
get into the fusion and get
absolutely
into the,
because when we met, that's what we were playing, a lot of fusion music again back in the day, and at that time listening to the old Gino Vanelli records,
turned
out years later we end up playing with
him. That's great.
Oh, went with Gino together?
Different
setups.
When he was, I think he's still here. I don't know.
No, he's gone.
He's pretty much. He's in Holland, but.
But when he was here, I think a lot of musicians play with him.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Well, I know, ever since you started, you became a very successful session drummer. And being the session drummer you are, and you've always been, you seem to have a very unique way of playing, or your own way of playing, and you have your own sound, basically.
Yeah.
Can you tell a little bit more about it, and can you elaborate on what it makes, what it is that makes your own sound?
Well, first of all, I think the sound is always the person. Because when I have a nice drum set, I play on it, and you will play on it, it will sound different.
Yeah.
So there's always, there's not so much magic in certain instruments. You can play on any instrument, and you can still sound as who you are. But I think also for me, I always use, for instance, like snare drum, I always use a 12-inch snare drum.
Okay.
So that's also typical
personal
sound.
Interest.
Yeah. And mostly small, how do you call it, small sizes, not too big. I'm not a heavy metal. I like, how do you call it, mid-high tone.
It's the same for your tom-toms and the bass drum?
Yeah. Well, bass drum can be old-fashioned also. When you put something in the bass drum, like they used to do, I like that kind of sound. It's really damped, but you can make a good sound out of it. Because nowadays it changed a little bit, you know. You see a lot of bass drum without anything, so they have more sub-low. But I like the old-fashioned, put a blanket in the bass drum and you have a boom, nice...
Works
kick.
Well in the studio and live.
It works nice in the studio and live, yeah.
But is there something about tuning or maybe the use of drum heads that you prefer? Or
well, that depends. When you have a drum set, especially now because I switched from, I always play Premier, I switched to Ludwig. Then with some sets you have to try different skins because it sounds totally different. Mm-hmm. So that's also, not every skin is working on the same
drum.
Yeah.
Right.
So sometimes you think, hey, that's a nice skin, but when you put it on, maybe when the shell is thin or whatever, then it sounds different. So you always have to, I'm still working on it. I think my whole life I'm working on sound.
Yeah.
It's with cymbals and it's with,
I do the
and you're
same.
Never...
you're never completely satisfied
or
ready.
Yeah.
But is it also that when you go in a studio, for example, and one night you play jazz or fusion type of thing, and the other day you play a poppy kind of thing, do you change your drum heads or do you have a certain kind of sound?
Yeah, well, I use two different sets. Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so one is a little bit bigger with, what is it? I think the bass drum is 22. And the other one is much smaller. So for jazzy gigs, it's a more open sound, smaller.
Right.
And for poppy, it's more a little bit bigger and more lower. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Cool. Yeah.
I noticed the last few years that we've done, say, gigs together. That you, I didn't see drum cases anymore.
No.
You just flopped it all in the car. And
I'm a very lazy guy and. And it's always in the car, out the car. So I think, why put it in cases and then in cases and then in the car? It's more work. And it's still looking good, the set. It's not really, how do you call it?
Yeah, you're always
messed
it's
up.
It's not worn out. Or
No. I'm, And also, there's one practical thing. Without any cases, it just, most of it, besides the bass drum, is fitting in the back of my car.
Oh,
and I can
nice.
Close it. So I can keep it in also during the night. When I come home and it's late, I just park my car.
All right.
And I keep everything
We won't
in.
Give up your address.
No, I don't. I didn't say that.
Yeah. Arnold, you were once asked back in, I think it was 1984, to be, to play drums with Rogier van Otterloo
with the
Metropole Orchestra. He was, of course, a fantastic
composer,
arranger, and conductor. And you were working there in the orchestra in the beginning, 50% of the time, basically.
Yeah.
Can you share some of those experiences with us? Because I know you guys played at that time with some big names internationally as well as some of the national names, you know?
Well, it's the funny thing is that it started, Rogier was asking me, because the Metropole Orchestra, they had some discussion with record companies. Mm-hmm. Because they told also, that every time the Metropole was in the news, they said, the record company said, but they can play jazz music, but they cannot play pop music. because there was a situation that the rhythm, there was a jazz rhythm section with Robbie Langerijs, Evert Overweg, Wim Overgaal.
Yeah, right.
And those guys were really good jazz musicians.
Fantastic jazz musicians, yeah.
But,
absolutely.
You know, the music changed, and so Rogier had a problem. And then he, through Margriet Eshuis, a well-known singer also, then he find out that he was just asking, he said, who are the best studio musicians we have doing all the pop records and everything? That was Jan Hollesteller, Lex Bolderdijk, and me. So he asked the whole group, he said, do you want to come with the orchestra so we can play pop music? And we said, okay, let's do it for a year, you know, like, okay, and we see what happens.
See what happens, right, right.
So that was funny, but in the beginning it was a little bit difficult because you had, everybody had to, how do you call it, get used to the fact that there is also, wasn't also a pop music coming up, you know, and that it was really different than the jazz music they played.
Absolutely, absolutely.
But in during all that time, I played with Herbie Hancock, Gino Vanelli, of course, that was great, Steve Vai, George Duke, so all the great cats, and that was great. That was really good part of the job, that you meet all those guys, Todd Rundgren, and play with them, and that's great. That's, who did that?
It must have been a lot of preparation for each show, I guess.
Mostly a week.
Mostly a week.
Yeah, mostly 4 days. And when it's really difficult, like Steve Vai, then we got the music a little bit sooner because that was really difficult.
Yeah.
What was the main difficulty in working with him on that?
Well, Steve Vai was that a lot of breaks, because normally like drum breaks, you know, it's like, okay, you see a bar fill.
Right.
That's easy, though. So you can just do whatever you want.
Right,
with Steve Vai, you see 7, 4, 3, 5, a lot of black dots, and you think, what could it be? So the first time I thought, well, probably some overreacted arranger who put out the whole drum fill. But when we started rehearsal, it was really completely synchronic with Steve. So I had to play it.
Right.
So I had to study all the fills.
I mean, Gino was like that as well. With his music. Very intricate, you know, the breaks would come in. There were certain breaks, as I know, working with him as a percussionist and backing vocalist, it was like, oh, well, you need to, there's a break has to come here. And he wanted to have a specific sound. If he could clone himself.
He would
times.
Do it by himself. Yeah.
That's what we used to always say.
Yeah.
But I mean, let's say not necessarily the easiest guy to work with, but learned a lot. That was a good learning phase working with him as well.
Yeah.
And that's the nice thing about working with some of the artists from outside again.
Yeah.
There's a whole different mentality that's brought into the music. And in this way, you create a new outlook.
Yeah, but it's also funny the difference between, let's say, pop and jazz in that kind of, because when you play with Hancock or George Duke and you ask something, the first thing they say, well, play what you feel, man.
It's much more free when you ask, shall I play this or that?
What do you feel? Play what you feel.
Right.
Yeah,
that's a totally different
Different thing.
Yeah,
that's a whole different
not
thing.
Not so arranged as the other.
No, the songs are there, but you know, you can change a lot of things by yourself for the whole rhythm section. You know, you can fill it in.
Yeah, and that's the personality. I think the personality of the artist as well. A lot of the instrumentalists have this sort of like, you know, just give me some sounds, you know, lay it down. This is the beat, man. Yeah. You know, go with the flow.
Yeah, because it was a lot of pop arrangements, they are fixed.
Right, exactly.
You just copy the original. You can put a little bit of yourself in it, but that's it.
Absolutely.
It's very...
Well, I mean, but the way I know you're known and among your colleagues is a fantastic sight reader, because you get a part in front of you no matter how difficult it is, and it's like it's all there.
I'm used to read, like a book. Yeah.
That was, I remember our first experience playing back in Florida again. At when you used to have your old house there in Florida,
you had
this sort of like living room studios where we used to sit and practice with some of the local guys, and there were these, you know, complicated patterns, and that were like boom, dead on the beat. You know, we were because we were listening to tomorrow, you know, all of this, the early fusion music, which was that was for our generation, us being from the same generation.
Yeah. That was
the music of our generation. Yeah. And we had so much fun. And the challenges were big, because when you went into the studio to do a pop session, it was like, I mean, for me, for you as well, it was either a straight beat, and or for me, you know, basic beats and stuff. But we got a chance to really play in the cafes and do our thing as musicians. It was a fun time, you know. Just,
you remember Babwana?
Yeah, man.
We had our own house band.
Yes, absolutely.
With part of Amazing Stroopwafels.
Yeah.
Fungus, and it was a combination of all the musicians in Vlaardingen.
Great times.
Yeah, it was great.
But as you said, Eddie, it must have been very challenging, and for you, very challenging to work with all those artists. But it's really musical challenging. What I'm wondering is, have there been some personal challenges over the years to stay on top of the game as being a professional drummer or being a musician in general?
Well, yeah, I hope everybody, but you're always, like a musician, you always stay a dreamer in that kind of way. And I just told downstairs,
Charles,
the cameraman, Charles. You don't see him, but he's over there. No, but that I still have a goal to work to, and the thing I like most, or I hope it will be successful, is to to form some kind of global band, because I work a lot since 2000 in the Middle East, and I met a lot of musicians in Armenia and in Egypt and in Syria, and I want to combine all those people in a band and make some kind of global
world
thing.
Music.
I hope, yeah. World music is sometimes just a little bit.
Kind of cheesy.
Yeah, it's more a world band, more global.
More global. Yeah, I understand what you mean.
Yeah,
because you're working also with Thijs Boersten, with his rhythm section, with his shows, where he's working with a lot of international.
The uitdaging
you guys are doing.
Starting this month.
Challenge. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Yeah. So I know that you guys are working together, and once in a while, when you can't make it, I usually fall in.
Yeah.
The percussion thing. So it's fun, but it's a fun project. Yeah. It's a fun project.
It's finally working. We put a lot of work in it, a lot of money, but now it's start to work. Yeah.
That's fantastic.
And it's not easy. The days it's now, with cultural.
Well, yeah, you know, it's hard to, to create a public for that. We have a generation of people, young kids today, that have grown up with computers, you know. It's all about sitting behind one of these things here and, doing everything behind the screen. And when we played, it was like you took your drums, you went to the cafe, or you went to a studio where there was a possibility to record, and you did your thing, you know, and that was that of course it was a new frontier. I guess you could say we were in that period like cowboys compared to what Star Wars is now today for the kids.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We didn't have an R2-D2, you know.
Yeah. It was
riding them hard, you know.
The whole time was different, but yeah, in a way. Okay, everything is changing, so you have to find a new way, because now I think CD, making a CD is not, I think nobody does, well, maybe you can do it, but it's more like a business card.
Yeah, it's
to,
more
to, business, to yeah. get somewhere, then you have the idea of selling a lot of CDs, because I think nobody is buying CDs anymore.
It's based on downloads.
Yeah,
but let me get back a little bit on what you said, like, you know, forming a world band or a global band. Looking at the challenges you've got personally there, can you elaborate a little bit more on that? What are the challenges that you are facing?
First of all, I have to go to. I plan to do it in spring, to go to Armenia and find out if I can find a good studio technician and some people to write with, because also as a drummer, I can write something, but I'm not the real composer. Mm-hmm. Always need some backup from, especially in chords or harmony, I need some backup. But I know a lot of different people, so I can combine a lot of good things and then see what happens. Just, it's very hard to say it's gonna be like this or that. I have to find it out, you know, during the process. And I think the goal of everything is to because there are a lot of, I know there are a lot of festivals in that region, you know, the Middle East, also the Mediterranean district. And when I can find somebody who can put the band, you know, in that kind of festivals, and then maybe I have a successful new thing. And I like to travel. I wish I was a gypsy. I prefer to be 6 months on the road and then 6 months maybe doing only writing or rehearsing. But
being at home.
Yeah, like, yeah. Okay, yeah.
That's a challenge on itself too.
Yeah.
Being on the road and being at home, and the difference between the life on the road and life at home.
And now I can do it because I have one child. I'm divorced, but I have one child. She's 25, living on her own. So now I'm free again. I can do what I want. You know, that makes it more easy because not everybody is in that situation.
Position, right.
No, because that's, I notice also with good musicians when I work with them and they have a small child, one or two, then okay, half of the time is already
gone.
And when you say, come on, we go to whatever country, then it's hard for people.
Yeah.
Did it affect your career at a certain point when you had to take care of your kid?
Yes, in a way, because I had my kid alone, so I was father mother for 10 years, and that affected a little bit. Yeah, I couldn't do everything.
That's a pretty big challenge.
Yeah, that was a big challenge. I have to find out from how can I do this, how can I do that, and how can I make her happy? You know, everything. It was a hard time.
But you managed to do it.
Yeah, and you know that they will grow up, and it will hopefully goes.
Before we close off, buddy, I like to, we always ask our guests if they have some kind of situation which was awkward or funny that they've been in the process of the whole
career. Lot of awkward.
You can tell me, you can share one of those stayed with you for.
Well, one thing what happened to me, because that scares you, you think about it never happened, but then it happened. It was I did a concert with George Duke, and it was directly on radio, I think. And there was one part I had a drum solo in it, and I was playing the drum solo, and then the guys, you know, the guys from stage, they forgot to, normally when you're on a riser or something higher than the rest, a little bit higher, then they make a small piece of wood that you can't get off. But they didn't do it, so I was, and then suddenly my whole chair and me
flipped over backwards.
So I dunk, and then with one hand I could. I thought, wow, what happened? And then, but then my brother called me, said, nice drum solo, but what happened during your drum solo? He said, yes, I fell off my chair during the concert. And also the orchestra, in the beginning, they were scary, but everybody had to laugh.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it's so funny. Somebody's playing it, doof.
And you fall back.
Still trying to play it.
Anyway, before we go, we want to thank you again for coming out, and it was fantastic to see you again after so many years, man. Yeah. I mean, we live, you know, of course, I'm across the border now, but it's only a...
How's the Belgium life, Eddie?
Oh, Belgium life is okay. I'm playing still a lot here. I'm halfway there, I'm half there, I'm half here, you know. But it's a lot of fun, it's interesting, different, completely different scene. But it has its let's say, experiences as well, you know. But I mean, it was lovely to have you on the show today and with us. And it's, of course, our first show in the new season. So it's, you know, TRFP, you know, that's what we're going to sort of like shorten off to in the future. And it's great to have such wonderful musicians like Arnold still around, still doing new things. And we want to thank you on behalf of my colleague, Mr. Peter D. You know, check us out on Facebook, on the Rhythm Factory Podcast. please click on like. If you go to our personal pages, we'll have those links on there. Any other information about Arnold, you can also find on the Rhythm Factory podcast page with a link to his website, the things that he's doing. Once again, thank you for this week. And remember, music is like fresh orange juice. Take those vitamins in and it'll brighten up your day. Ciao.
That sounds good.